Hiya, my name's Dan. I'm a professional animator who's, like, really into video games. This is Video Game Animation Study, and this time we're going to look at the animation of Metal Slug. Firstly, if you find yourself enjoying this episode, then please consider subscribing to the channel and liking the video, as this really helps the channel grow. So after conducting audience research into their favourite piece of animation from Metal Slug to help shape this episode, it ended up with everyone loving everything. So this kind of just put me back at the start. What I've decided to do, which will be much easier to digest, is focus on one or two particular pieces of animation after going over a few fan favourites. But before we properly deep dive on some animation, let's go over the research. Developer interviews and coverage are pretty scant on the Metal Slug series, but there are tidbits around the internet. In a developer interview with Neo Geo magazine, NASCAR, who were later absorbed into SNK, speak of their main design concepts being to portray a good sense of speed, weight and power, everything being clear and identifiable on screen, and it all being stylish and cool. NASCAR said a core concept was a refreshing game overflowing with flash and extravagance that would relieve daily stress, and that they wanted player characters to feel real to the world and not be boring, even if it meant extravagant animation that didn't aid the gameplay any further. Specifically with Metal Slug 2, NASCAR said, in the 3D polygon era today, people won't be satisfied with 2D unless it's at this level. So they were very conscious to make sure the animations were insanely high quality to compete with modern 3D games at the time. This is why the animations look incredibly smooth and detailed. Some have speculated that 3D tools were used to aid in this sprite art production, but honestly, I think these were just some world-class pixel animators who knew their stuff. Perhaps some 3D production was used later on, but the titles that got the series started, at least, were all 2D produced, I can confidently say that. From the small bits I've gleaned, clear and strong identification on screen with high-quality, smooth and stylized animation and fun escapism is what was most important to the developers during art production. And it shows. You'll see a lot of the time that characters and enemies are much more vivid than the sometimes flatter and lighter looking background, helping to identify the action clearly on screen. Not that that helps me in that regard. Enemy movement and deaths are often super detailed, consisting of many frames, even for something simple like falling to the side. But it's this insane amount of detail that gives the game its strong depiction and understanding of 3D space and movement. I believe this is what contributes to that feeling of satisfaction and excitement when you're facing off against one of Morden's many maniacal machines. Metal Slug is a beautiful series held dearly by all and has inspired loads of games like Alien Hominid, Shantae, Mega Man Zero, and many others. Let's have a brief look at some fan favourite animations before I study one particular piece. Okay, so like I said before, audience feedback was varied into what people actually viewed as the best piece of animation in the series, and I don't have the time or stamina to go through each and every game with each and every thing. Many of you liked the zombie vomit animation, and it's the way in which your character creepily arches their head in the smoothest way possible and sprays out this projection of vomit which damages everything on screen. The gravity and flow of the vomit is really convincing and realistic for an action-packed, exaggerated game, and like most things in the game, it's really satisfying. Actually makes me think of this bit in Yoshi's Island. We couldn't talk about animation in Metal Slug without mentioning the insanely high-quality explosions that happen. It'd be crazy enough that they had one brilliant-looking explosion, but there's a whole plethora of different-looking explosions for different things. There's so many gradients of colour and loads of frames, and the shape and behaviour is, again, very satisfying. You can check out my video on the art of explosions for a more in-depth look at this topic, where Metal Slug explosions are a main focus. Check it out here! Everyone seems to enjoy the character animations, such as the running animation, which I don't personally like, but I appreciate its appeal. To me, it just seems a bit floaty and unconvincing, but then it is meant to be a little daft and comical. I just feel it could have done with a bit of a head bob, which you all know I bloody love in a run animation. The idle, shooting, and aiming animations are all cool as well. Even when you die in some games, you have this kinda over-the-top death, and sometimes a death depends on how you were killed, too. It just gives the game a little bit of extra character and soul. Many of the bosses are incredibly detailed and fun to defeat, and make good use of polished looping segments and understanding of space to create a big, menacing presence. Some are better than others, however, like there's a couple that are just static things that float around. But some, like these, have lots of different moving parts. And it gives this sense that the thing is there, in the space it occupies and is alive. And it makes it much more convincing and fun to defeat. Like, quick example, you can have an idle animation on something just standing still, but you can add delays to different segments, which is a form of secondary animation, and before you know it, you've got all these little individual pieces of movement that add up to this really textured-looking thing, and that's the trick they use with some of the bosses, to keep it looking interesting and alive. Pretty much any piece of animation on display would be worthy of a video by itself. But here's where we come to my chosen piece for this game series. The titular vehicle itself, the Super Vehicle 001, Metal Slug. What I particularly like, and what I think is its strength, is its almost organic look. Though it's a metal tank, its design gives it a more bouncy, rubbery look. This appearance allows the vehicle to become incredibly expressive and cartoony. I mean, let's just look at this thing. The smoothness of the turret kind of makes it look like a cranium, so we'd be forgiven in thinking this is its head, which pushes us into anthropomorphic territory, allowing us to connect a bit more to it. Okay, that might be a stretch, but not for me, because I love this thing and want one as a pet, or a toy. It's got cute proportions for a tank, especially when compared to other enemy tanks, which are slightly sharper and heavier looking. You've got the turret and main body bobbing up and down when both static and moving, but separate to the tracks, so you've got this sense that it's got different moving parts that are loosely connected. The tracks themselves aren't perfect either. They kind of bulge out, like if you were squeezing a long balloon. And this kind of affects the weight of the tank. As you move back and forward, it's really bouncy, like the suspension is on 200% or something. When you move forward, there's this combination of an up and down bob, and also a side to side bob, further reinforcing this idea that it has different joints and connections and that it has actual moving parts, as well as being an almost cheerful character in and of itself. When it jumps, the separate treads almost act as legs, and you've got this nice bouncy movement as it lands, which gives it a much softer feel that counters the hard, jagged caterpillar tracks. Also, I mean, this tank can duck. That's how almost alive it is. It obeys all the rules something living would do, adhering to principles like squash and stretch and anticipation and the like. When it suffers a hit, the turret gets knocked to one side, which can alternate between right and left. It's cute. It looks like it's been punched in the face and takes a second to recover. No mechanical thing would react like this, and that's the beauty of animation in that you can imbue anything with relatable characteristics. I don't know about you, but I get sad when Metal Slugs explode. Metal Slugs feel alive and full of character. I thought I'd contrast this by studying a boss as well, to see what else they do. And I thought I'd study the best opposite to the Metal Slug vehicle, and that's Metal Rear from Metal Slug 5, which is, in essence, a huge renegade prototype based on the Metal Slug design. What's interesting, and something I wasn't actually expecting, especially when compared to other bosses, is just how alive this one feels as well. Most of the design of the thing itself is pretty counter to the Metal Slug, such as straighter edges, less rounded corners, a much less organic look, and much more of a solid, complex machine, giving off a more cold and calculating appearance. And yet, it's probably still as expressive as Metal Slug. I mean, the evidence of this is when it literally rears up into a wheelie and tries to crush you, landing with such a follow-through with all the pieces catching up to the action. This, again, feels alive. And I think this is where the series charm lies, giving big mechanical machines more life and soul than would ever work in the 3D scene of the time. And I think this is what they meant during that interview, that the animation and art has to be this good to be able to compete in this new market. Without going into it too much right here, I actually found out about Metal Slug 3D for the PS2 from 2006, which kind of backs up my point in this particular case. Enemies and bosses lack that lively, convincing movement, and it just doesn't feel the same. Another thought I keep having is how the series progresses into more and more creepy imagery. From simple world domination war vehicles in Metal Slug 1 and 2, and entering more supernatural territory in 3 onwards, with the odd-looking aliens circling the crashed spaceship thing and the Root Mars boss at the end. I find that the smoothness of some of the movements fits ever more into this uncanny creepiness, and it matches up well with the overall aesthetic the later games find themselves in. I think this begins to make more sense when you encounter the aliens and monsters with guns that just move so smoothly, it's almost unsettling to watch. The spider tank, for example, though not quite in supernatural territory, has this constant motion which actually gives off this sickening insect-like creepiness. Usually, animation which lacks the sort of easing that's present in Metal Slug would perhaps face criticism, particularly when it's present in an action-heavy game like this. But it just works in Metal Slug. The amount of detail, the amount of frames, the amount of understanding of space and the amount of appeal in these games are definitely what drive up the quality. Pixel art and animation is really prolific these days, more than it's been for ages, and games like Owlboy and many others show just how strong the skill set is for this aesthetic, and there's clearly a hunger for more high-quality pixel art games. Personally, I feel there's still room to explore and progress this style, and I think we have Metal Slug to thank for pushing these boundaries far beyond what we thought we could do. Thanks for watching this one, and thanks to these bloody brilliant people for supporting my channel. Considering supporting the channel yourself if you want to continue seeing more content like this. Only takes $1 a month. See you next time. Love you, bye.